Welcome back to the podcast, everyone. Very excited today to have Justin Welsh with me. Justin, over the last decade, has helped build two $50 million revenue companies, teams of over 150 people, and those companies have gone on to raise over $300 million in venture capital. And in 2019, Justin walked away from a high-paying executive job at a hyper-growth startup in Los Angeles to go work for himself. Our paths crossed for the first time a few years ago when he was still at the startup, transitioning into his life as a solo entrepreneur. And for the last year, Justin has been involved with various business ventures, running a boutique advisory firm for early stage SaaS entrepreneurs, building digital products and courses for creators, and running a private LinkedIn community, and being a mentor for startups and investors, especially in the B2B SaaS space. So I'm very excited to have you on, Justin. And I want to start this conversation a few years back, at the point when you decided to leave the startup patient pop and go on to start your own business. Can you tell me more about what led to that decision and what that transition was like?
Yeah, absolutely. First of all, it's great to be here. Good to see you again, Malte. And it's a lot of fun chatting with you and the team. I got into technology in 2009. And the first company that I started at was a company called ZocDoc. And I was living in New York City. ZocDoc had a culture of really high performance. And so for the first 5 years of technology, like I worked 80-hour work weeks, you know, we worked really hard. We stayed up really late. We got up really early. And when I transitioned in to become the VP of sales at Patient Pop, I brought a lot of that energy and culture to the company. And I went on to spend 5 years there as well. So after 10 years at really fast-growing companies with really high-performance cultures, you know, you start to burn out, you start to get tired. And I think for me, it was all about kind of taking a step back and looking at how that had impacted myself, both mentally and physically. I was sleeping less. I was eating more, drinking more, heavier than I had ever been. And at one point, I think it was in December of 2018, I actually had like a panic attack, like what you would call like a breakdown, where the ambulance came and I thought I was dying. And it was actually really, really traumatizing and really just scary because I hadn't had one before. And so that was like the last sort of the straw that broke the camel's back, for lack of a better saying. And I knew I needed to change. And so I knew most of that would come from stepping out of my role and taking a break. That was what caused that. The journey that I started after that panic attack has been a 2.5 year journey, and been able to get my mental health, my physical health, how much I work, how much I sleep, all back on track. And I thought that it would be just a quick, you know, rest working for myself, and it's going well. And I, you know, fingers crossed that it continues to keep growing.
Not many people find the courage to take that step. I can imagine it's quite scary leaving so much of what you've built behind for something new. How have things been going since? What have you been up to?
Things are going great. And like, I would say, I don't even know that it's fair to call it courage, because I don't think it was very courageous. I think it was just forced. It was necessary. And so I admire those folks who like do it when things are going really well and their mental and physical health are you know, full steam ahead. So mine was more forced, but things are going great. I'm a tinkerer by nature. And so when I first started working for myself, like, I thought I would do consulting. I thought I would just kind of spin up a consulting firm. And so I did that. And it went really well. I had been building my presence on social media. People knew my name and face. People were aware of my accomplishments. And so when I announced that I was going on my own, we got a lot of clients right away. And I've been filled with clients since that day. But I think what's been more interesting is as I've spent more time online, I've been learning a lot about different industries. Outside of SaaS and outside of, you know, healthcare technology and startup companies. And, you know, I started learning about creating, building digital products, running communities, no code tools. And so as I've learned a lot about those, I just started building. I just started building little things, products, communities. I'm building a new business. That's a tech-enabled service business right now that I'm just sort of beta testing right now. And I've never really considered myself or called myself a single time until about 2 or 3 weeks ago, like an entrepreneur. But I started to think like, yeah, I might not be building a $100 million SaaS business of my own again, but it's been really fun to work for myself and to see it be, to see it work and not have to go back into the startup world. It's been pretty awesome.
Congrats. It's not a small feat. And I saw a post somewhere that you generated over $1 million in income over the last year. Is that right?
Yeah. So far, I just crossed about 1.3 million in income in 2 years at about, you know, 98% margins. It's a one-man show. My wife is extraordinarily supportive in the business. When I say it's a one-man show, I mean, I don't technically have any employees. Yeah, it's been great. My wife is super helpful with the community. She helps me stay organized. But it's just kind of me and some no code tools and you know, some friends, you know, online, LinkedIn, Twitter. I'm loving that. And the income has been better than what I was making as an executive in software. And so my expectation was that would not happen. I would have been okay making half. And just working for myself. The fact that I've been able to figure out how to build a few more businesses has been really exciting.
A lot of people listening, I'm sure, would consider this the dream job. You're working for yourself. You don't have to deal with the headaches and pains that can come with running a large team and those responsibilities. Mm-hmm. And you make your own schedule and so on. And you're making really good money. What's been the biggest challenge for you during this time?
It's to make sure that I don't fall into the same routine as before. I naturally love to work. Like the idea of retiring or working less than I work now is not super, you know, that doesn't really feel like a win for me. I like to work. I like to spend time. It's to make sure that I don't spend so much time that I'm up late and up early and doing some of the same things that I did back in late 2018, or early 2019. I also think another challenge is that when you run a community specifically, you're always on. There are 500 members from 51 countries across the world. Someone's always in the community. It's a synchronous community run on Slack. Someone's always asking questions. Someone is always chattering. Someone is always doing something. So even if you have a gap of 2 hours in your calendar, that's still in the background and you know it's there and you have to go there and you want to make sure you're participating a lot. So that becomes challenging from a balancing your time perspective. I think there's a lot of addiction in social media. I think that when you write content and it becomes popular, that likes and engagements and comments and everything are very much like a slot machine. I think a lot of people try and pretend like it doesn't bother them or impact them, or they think about it. Everyone does. And I'm no different. I'm just a person who gets excited about, you know, engagement and on social media. So it's not becoming obsessed with that. It's not spending 7 hours in a row in front of the computer. It's a lot of the same things that I dealt with when I was working at PatientPop. Again, my support system, my wife is the most important person who reminds me it's time to take a break. It's time to go for a walk. It's time to do the things that we can do and are fortunate enough to be able to do now that I don't have a boss or meetings or, you know, board members or anything like that.
Do you have any advice for folks that are out there thinking about taking a similar step and going out on their own?
One of the best things you can do if you're going to go out on your own is create attention. And like attention, people say, is new currency. It's been overused, right? Creator economy, attention currency, all these different things. But it's true. My hypothesis before going to work for myself was that the most attention that I could create, like the more, the better. And so I wanted people to see my name, my face, my thoughts every day. No matter what social media channel you log into, I want me to be at the top. And by doing that, even if you don't know what you're creating attention for, you can leverage that attention and turn it into businesses. And it's much harder to build a business when you don't have attention. And so if you're thinking about doing that, start building your brand online. Start going onto social media, Twitter, LinkedIn, YouTube, Instagram, doesn't matter, your medium of choice, whatever you will stay consistent with. You like taking pictures, go on Instagram. You like writing, write on Twitter. and go out there and start sharing your expertise, sharing your thoughts. If you can grow a nice following of people who hold you in high regard, when you go out on your own, you have a network, beta testers, partners. There are so many different things that you have by creating attention that give you a leg up on the folks who haven't done that.
I'm curious, since when you started, you had the experience of having built very large teams, very successful companies, and a very particular and useful skill set around sales, right? Teaching people how to sell, teaching people how to manage other sellers. And I imagine that this expertise was really foundational to the content you created, the courses you created. Would you say that it's possible for someone to go out on their own and do this if they haven't had a previous career or, you know, some level of expertise that they bring with them?
The assumption that people make all the time is that, like, oh, you were the VP of sales and, you know, at Patient Pop, and that's helpful. That's why you are popular on LinkedIn or whatever. There's lots of people who have very similar roles who have tried writing every day and don't succeed. And so I'd say it's actually a lot less about my previous experience at Patient Pop. There are some things which I can talk about that I think were really important in going out on my own. To me, it's just about writing well. And I still don't consider myself to be a good writer. I consider myself someone who studies writing a lot, because I realized that social media levels the playing field. Like, the more you stand out, the better. And the easiest way to stand out is to learn to write effectively, to learn to write really good copy, to understand persuasion, to understand long form. And then I think where Patient Pop and like selling and things like that come in is the psychology. So like, I like to think that I know enough about why people make choices, why people buy things, FOMO, you know, all these different things that cause people to make purchases. I use that psychology from my previous role. I partner that with just studying a lot of copywriting, reading a lot of people who are really good writers, writing a lot. And I think the two of those things together have been really beneficial for me.
How do you come up with the ideas for content?
You need a niche. You need to talk about something specific. You can't just be like, I help businesses grow. Like, that's what a lot of people say. Like, for me, on my sales side, I help early stage SMB SaaS companies in the healthcare technology vertical grow towards $50 million in recurring revenue. Pretty niche, right? And when I'm thinking about creators, it's I help one person creators, right, scale their first online business to six figures. Like, it's pretty niche. And so what I do is I think, okay, I've got my audience. The next thing that I have to do is understand what are the most common topics that my audience wants to hear about. So I will list those topics. I'll list them in sort of high level content, audience growth, productization, monetization. And then underneath each of those high level topics, I will break them down into a bit more of a granular fashion. So like for digital products, it might be time boxing, launching, creating, video, all of these different topics underneath just building a product. And then across the top of my matrix, I use styles and structures. So ways of writing that I know resonate with people, listicles, observations, past versus present, X versus Y, contrarian. There's all these different sort of things that ways that I write. And what I do is I just match those things up. So I'll match up, how to time box your product launch with observation. Seven observations that I've made about people who time box their product launches really effectively. And that's just a topic. And now I can just riff on it. And so for me, writing and looking at a blank piece of paper has always been really challenging. If I can slap a bunch of ideas down on pieces of paper and then write underneath them, that to me is a lot easier and a way for me to create 7 or 10 pieces of content at once.
Do you have a particular structure to your day or to your week that you go through and some routines that help you produce this content consistently?
I try to be blinded by structure because I think when you're in a business that requires creativity, structure can often be the enemy of that. But as a structured person, yes. So generally, I wake up at about 6. My LinkedIn content comes out each morning at 7:15 Central Time. So I carve about 45 minutes out to interact with people. Spend 45 minutes on LinkedIn. I go for a 6-mile walk with my wife. That's our exercise for the day. Come back, have some lunch. In the afternoon, I'm working with my community. I usually carve out an hour to write. But if I'm writing and I'm like on fire with ideas, I might write for 3 hours. if I sit there for the first half an hour and can't think of anything, I'll close my computer. I have found that on the weekends over a cup of coffee, I generally feel the least stressed, the most creative, the least tied down. So I do a lot of writing on the weekends as well, just because I enjoy it. So yeah, that's pretty much my you know, day-to-day and weekly schedule.
A few things that you mentioned that I want to dive into. And the first one I want to start with is you mentioned building a community, and you have 500 members that are engaging with this community. What led to the decision to start this community? And how did you go about building it and bringing in the first people and then ultimately growing it to the size that it is at now?
There are two reasons that I started it. One is selfish and the other is unselfish. So I think we'll start with the one that's unselfish. To me, when I got started building my own businesses online, I felt very lost. I didn't know how to write. I didn't know what to write about. I didn't know how to build websites. I didn't know how to validate ideas. I didn't know how to price things. I didn't know how to even really sell myself. Even as a salesperson, like pitching your own product is very different than pitching a company's product. And I think it becomes a lot more nerve-wracking. So to those folks that are trying to do the same thing that I started doing 2.5 years ago, this is something that I wish existed. I wish there was a community that I had joined where I could bounce ideas, share best practices, ask questions, talk to people who are ahead of me in their journey. So from an unselfish perspective, that's why I started it. I wanted people to have the opportunity to learn with other people who are going through similar challenges. From a selfish perspective, it's also a great way for me to test ideas, right? Deploy products, get feedback, learn things that I normally wouldn't be able to learn from people with different levels of competency than I have. And so those are a lot of maybe what I might call the selfish reasons that I started a community. When I decided to do it, I made this another hypothesis. I thought, okay, I think asynchronous conversations aren't fun. Like LinkedIn is already asynchronous. Like I post and like someone writes on it 30 minutes later, and maybe I come back 2 hours later and write something back, and that's the end of the conversation. I had this hypothesis that people would want to talk in real time. And so I actually started my community on something called Discord, which is a Slack competitor, but more around gaming. And I went out and I crafted my sales pitch, which was, this didn't exist for me and it made it really hard. How'd you like to shortcut a lot of the mistakes that I made and come learn with other people who are just like you? That message resonated with a lot of people. So I pumped that message a lot. Like that was my message behind this community. And I did it for a long time before I launched. And then when I launched, I had 300 people join right away. And I continue to grow it mostly through word of mouth. I think when people see their content getting traction, when they build their first business, when they make their first $1,000 and they thought, I've never going to make any money online, and they do it, that prompts them to go tell their friends, and their friends come to me, they sign up. And we've got this really cool flywheel sort of, you know, enter, have a lot of fun, gain a lot of experience, get the right outcome, tell a friend, that friend comes in, that friend goes through the same experience, and it just kind of keeps growing very naturally.
That's awesome. And is this all on LinkedIn? Because you've become known as a LinkedIn marketing expert at this point. Curious to hear how that happened.
I looked at LinkedIn and I saw a lot of people behaving really professionally. I saw a lot of like, here's my resume, here's my new job, here's my case study, my white paper. And I thought, this is ripe for a little bit of what Twitter has. Like Twitter is more like, it's less professional, it's less buttoned up, it's more, you know, polarizing. And so I decided to treat LinkedIn like Twitter instead of treating it like LinkedIn. And I think because no one else was doing that back in early 2019, my content stood out. And like a lot of the things that I do, once I get excited about something, I want to learn everything that I can learn about it. And so I went out and was like, what are the best first lines I've written, second lines that I've written, third lines that I've written? How do I get more people to my content faster? How do I make sure that people, when they're finished with my content, leave comments and engage with it? How do I do all these things? So I started just studying how that works. And I've built, you know, 130,000 person following. And I like to keep the community structured around LinkedIn. I think if you want to run a really thriving community, your members have to have common experiences, or else everyone is talking about something dramatically different. And so everyone who's in my community is active on LinkedIn, and they've also taken my course. So we all speak the same language. We all have the same jargon. There's commonality amongst all the members. And so over the last 3 years, the following just kind of keeps growing. It's just one post a day, writing in the morning at 7:15.
For people who want to grow their LinkedIn following, what are some of the basics and what are some of the differences to other social media platforms?
Number one, there has to be a reason to pay attention to you. And once you get someone to pay attention, you have to be interesting enough of a person for them to decide to spend their valuable time following you, clicking the follow button and deciding that your content is worthwhile. And so there are two pieces to that. The first piece is be interesting online. Say interesting things. Don't say things we all know, right? Like people go on LinkedIn every day and they say things like, we should treat our SDRs, you know, similar to how we treat our AEs. No kidding. We all know that, right? It doesn't need to be said. Saying obvious things will get you some engagement from some folks. But I think what you need to figure out is, how do you take a different angle? How do you say something that's a little bit more polarizing, not divisive? It's not meant to be divisive. It's meant to share strong opinions that you truly believe in. And if 70% of the people agree with you and 30% of the people disagree with you, you've got nice polarization. And then what you're essentially doing is you're building yourself as a political candidate, right? You want your tribe of followers to actively become more deeply entrenched with your message, the more people tell them not to be entrenched by it, right? Think about any presidential candidate we've had in this country, right? Doesn't matter who you pick. You go try and tell someone they're not voting for the right guy or gal, they dig their heels in deeper. That's what creating a persona on LinkedIn is all about. And then you need to make sure that once people are following your ideas, they're following your persona, they believe in the same things that you believe in. When they land on your profile, it's got to be like a sales page or a landing page. It has to give people all of the reasons that they should spend their valuable time following you. So for me, that's a professional headshot, a great banner image, an about section with a lot of social proof, tons of testimonials from people that you've worked with. You need to build your profile the same way that a SaaS company builds a landing page for a product.
What about the posts themselves? A lot of people ask, is it text? If so, how long? Should we post images? Should we post videos? Do you have any advice on the types of posts that perform well and the structure of the posts that tends to perform well?
The best advice I have for posts that perform well are posts that you actually hit post on. Submit. And the biggest thing that I see people do is they post for like 7 days and then they get tired. And so they stop. So my advice around like image, text, video, audio is do what you are most likely to keep doing. So for me, I like to write. So therefore I am most likely to keep writing. I don't like to be on video. So if I had to pick up my phone every day and record a video, I would probably stop doing that. With that being said, I have found that text posts are most effective. As far as the structure, there's a pretty common structure that I sort of teach people, which is the first line is called the scroll stopper. Like everyone's scrolling on their phones, they're scrolling on their you know, laptop. And that first line has got to give people a reason to stop and say, what else am I going to read about this particular post? So it's got to be polarizing, sharp, hard, sharp language, sharp, harsh words, negative words, hyper-positive words. You've got to get people to stop. The second line is sort of a confirmation line or an empathy line where you let people know something about the first line where I've been there, or you continue to drive home the point of the first line, but not so sharply, not so harshly. It's really just sort of biding time to the third line. And the third line is what you call the hook line. And it's the last line before the see more appears. And if you can get people to click see more, you've now at least earned their attention for the rest of the post. Once you click see more, you're kind of going to read. It's like opening an email, right? Once you open an email, you're much more likely to read it. My goal is to get them to click see more. And if I can get them to do that, the next thing I have to do is deliver the meat. And the meat to me is like, okay, what's the actual stuff that people are going to learn from this post? So yeah, I've hooked them with the opening. Now I got to teach them something. And then at the end of the post is what I call just like a really simple recap, because I want someone to leave a comment. And if they have to scroll back up and read through the entire post to remember everything they read to then engage, they become less likely to engage. So I summarize everything very succinctly and very quickly. And then I ask a question, either a call to action or a call to conversation. A call to action to buy a product, go to a website, listen to a podcast. A call to conversation to say, do you agree? Do you disagree? What would you add? What are some other things that I didn't mention? Why am I wrong? Why am I right? There are a million different calls to conversation that get people talking in the comments section. And so it's really scroll stopper, hook line, meet, recap, call to conversation. And that's sort of my structure for every post.
You mentioned you have 130,000 followers now. How many did you start with 2.5 years ago?
2,500.
2,500. Yes. That's pretty incredible growth. Can you give the listeners an idea of the type of engagement you get on a typical post?
Yeah, on a typical post, I get about 130,000 impressions. So it'll be seen 130,000 times in people's feed. I average about 1,200 what you might call engagements, simple word for likes, right? People clicking like or heart or clap or whatever. And then roughly around 300 to 350 comments per post. And so I'll do about 300 days of posting this year. So I'll probably end up around 40 million impressions. Some of the more viral stuff, you know, gets a few million impressions, 15,000 engagements, 2,000 comments. But recently I'm starting about 2 weeks ago, I started writing on Twitter every day. And I've gone from 6,000 to 19,000 followers very quickly on that platform. And I'm starting to recognize that there's I think, a lot more viral effects on that platform. And so I'm using what I've learned over the past 3 years on LinkedIn to transition into Twitter so I can have a nice balance of two platforms versus one.
Yeah, and there are definitely parallels between those two platforms. I find that both of those tend to center around ideas more than visual aspects. And so I imagine a lot of the content that you're creating for LinkedIn, if you are creating short versions of it, snippets of it, they will translate pretty well into Twitter.
That's right. I think one of the easiest cheats is to write a blog post, to write a long form article, turn it into a Twitter thread, and then take each piece of the thread and turn it into standalone LinkedIn pieces of content.
If you were a real estate agent, or if you were starting a real estate business, how would you think about using social media? And if you want to make it specific to LinkedIn, feel free to take this any way you want. But it'd be interesting to hear what advice you would give to real estate agents looking to get started.
Yeah, it's interesting. I actually did a corporate speaking engagement for a real estate software company that employs agents just recently. And so I'll tell you what advice I gave them. As a two-time home buyer, the home buying experience often for the buyers is not very good. Like both of my home buying experiences were not very good. And it's confusing. You feel lost. You feel taken advantage of. You don't understand really who's on your side because the agents are getting commission. So you're like, is this person really have my best interest in mind? Or do they just care about getting this deal closed at the highest price possible? So you have all these questions. So I think if I were to go out and start creating a brand for a real estate agent on social media, the first thing I'd do is make an enemy. And the enemy would be that experience, the agent who puts you through that experience. That's your enemy. Once you have an enemy, it's time for you to start throwing rocks at that person. And if you throw rocks at that person and your audience feels the same pain that you're describing and they start throwing rocks at that person, and I say this person as a persona, right? Then they start to gravitate towards you. So you start talking about it's unfair the way that buyers go through the experience. It's unfair that there's no visibility and transparency. It's really terrible that you feel taken advantage of, that you don't understand who's on your side. And guess what? That's why Jim, the real estate agent's here to help save you. So I think it's creating an enemy. It's content that throws rocks at that enemy continuously. It's generating trust through that content. It's getting people on your side. And then, oh, by the way, when it's time for them to buy a house and they want a crystal clear, simple, and easy experience, they're going to come to the guy or gal that's been writing content about it. So that's how I think about it.
That's really fantastic advice. For those out there who want to learn more and who want to maybe take your course, where can they go to learn more about you and your business?
Yeah, if you want to learn about me, it's pretty simple. It's just justinwelsh.me. It's W-E-L-S-H.me. So justinwelsh.me. And if you want to learn about the LinkedIn course, you can go to theoperatingsystem.co, theoperatingsystem.co.
Go check it out, everyone. It's worth it. And hope you all enjoyed this conversation. Justin, thanks so much for joining me. It's been an absolute pleasure. I learned a lot and hope to have you on again sometime in the future. There's a lot more I could ask you.
Cool. It's been a real pleasure, Malte. It's great seeing you again.